Morning to all of you. First of all, I would like to thank the organizer for giving us the opportunity to present our work and the kind of facility which RRCAT has now. So my talk would be mainly focused on the activities we are performing at RRCAT and laser facilities which are available at our center for performing ultra-intensity laser plasma interaction experiments. So, and in this talk, I will be just briefly covering our recent results on ion acceleration. Whereas for electron acceleration, my colleague Dr. Murthy will be presenting, and simulation work will be presented by Dr. Ajit Upadhyay. So, let us go. First, I will just brief on the major activities at RRCAT. Then laser facilities at laser plasma section at RRCAT. Then we have got upcoming plan of petawatt laser facility. So that will be available maybe next year at the end. So that I will be briefing on that. And then recent studies on ion acceleration and important results. And finally, I will conclude my talk. I think this problem is okay. The center is located almost at the heart of the India, and this is the Google map of our center. So basically it houses major activity of synchrotron radiation source that is we called national facility Indus 1 and Indus 2. Indus 1 is a 450 MeV electron machine and Indus 2 is 2.5 GeV electron machine, and it has got many beam lines available for universities for doing experiments on synchrotron radiation source. And then rest of the activity is all related to laser development and application of lasers in different fields. So we are located somewhere here. So this is a nice campus with a lot of nature you can see here. And so as I mentioned that we got to facility of synchrotron radiation source. And then laser plasma section at RRCAT is involved in laser plasma interaction studies, and we have got TASFR laser facility operating at 10 terawatt and 150 terawatt, and the center soon will have 1 petawatt 25 femtosecond TASFR laser. So using these lasers we are involved in ultra intensity laser matter interaction covering different aspects like studies on laser wake field, field acceleration, ion acceleration in thin foils, neutron generation and time resolved X-ray diffraction, high-head generation and high harmonic generation in plasma plumes. So I'll be giving our experiment result for ion acceleration in thin foils. So coming to laser facility, so this is our 10 terawatt TASFR laser facility. So it is operating at 45 femtosecond pulse duration, peak power is 10 terawatt, 10 hertz repetition rate, and contrast is 10 to the minus 6. So this is in operation since 2006. So our earlier experiment results are all were using these lasers, and from 2015 onwards we got 150 terawatt laser in operation. So it is working at 23 femtosecond with a peak power of 150 terawatt and at 500 repetition rate. The contrast of this pulse is about 10 to minus 10 at 300 picosecond, because for any such laser pulse contrast is very important factor, parameter which will finally decides your interaction regime. And this can be focused to 10 to the power 20 watt per centimeter square. Now coming to petawatt facility, this is a building layout. So we got a huge big hall for housing the petawatt laser, which is about 12 meters by 24 meters. And this service corridor will house all major power supplies of the laser system. And then there is huge interaction area. You can see this thick area, which is shown here, it is 1 meter thick concrete to confine the radiation which are emitting during the experiments. And this is again 16 by 16 meter, a big hall for performing such experiments. So this is a building view, that the building is ready. And this is a laser hall, which is almost at the final finishing touch. And then this is interaction area, which is 1 meter thick concrete all around. And this is also very huge, 16 by 16 meters. So these are the plan which will be carrying out on this petawatt laser. We'll have three bays. One we identified as X-ray bay. Here we'll be doing X-ray generation using petawatt. Then there is a ion bay. Here we'll be doing ion acceleration experiments. And third would be electron bay. That is for electron acceleration. So we have this initial layout where we have plasma mirror here. So there are different views by which we can take the beam. Like if you want to use plasma mirror for high contrast, then you can have beam through this plasma mirror for an acceleration. Or just removing this mirrors, we can have beam without plasma mirror to electron acceleration experiment, and for similarly for X-ray generation. Yeah, another layout. Now coming to our studies on ion acceleration, the question is why ion beams are so important. There is already you heard in the morning talk by Mohanty and all that ions are required to study deep into the matter. Similarly, there are another important application of ion, which is in the oncology radiation experiment. There, if one uses ion beam for cancer therapy purpose, then it has a very localized heating without leading to much collateral damage. So one of the important ion laser generated ion excess source is invoiced for oncology studies. So if you see, there are many facilities which are coming around the world only targeted for ion accelerator for only oncology applications. So we have also major plan of using ion beams for our medical application. And of course, ion beam is already known to use for various schemes. Now, ultra-short intense laser ion sources are potential alternative to conventional RF source because they require very small space compared to huge accelerator facilities, and they are very cheap compared to conventional RF based accelerator. So for this audience, I perhaps not be very known, well known about this ion acceleration scheme, which actually takes place under during ultra-intensive laser plasma interaction. So when you irradiate such an ultra-short high-intensity laser pulse on a thin foil target, then basically laser intensity is coupled to hot electrons, and these hot electrons are escaping from the plasma which is created. If you have enough thin target, then they can even lead, they can transmit through the foil, and they can create a space charge behind the target foil and creating a huge electric field, which is given by simple this relation, which is order of tera volt. So under such a huge field, one can get a ion acceleration which can go up to easily up to tens of MeVs. And of course, in the front also you have ions which are coming out, and that also create a charge. But here, since it is a bulk of the plasma, so that way the field is not very huge, but you can get ion acceleration in both direction. And if you see, the ion energy is simply dictated by the temperature of the hot electrons. So if you achieve hot electron temperature more and more, one can get high energy. Yeah, here also few MeV easily. It depends again on the different laser parameters, okay, and your target geometry. So this is our experimental setup, which we are using for this ion experiment. So we have a beam which is focused on a thin foil target. Then we can monitor our ion emission from both direction, from the target rear as well as from the front. And then we've got another beam diagnostics which measures scattered light from the target foil, and then monitor the angular distribution of the ion emission using Faraday cup and all. So here we are using Thomson parabola as a measure, our main ion detector diagnostics to measure online monitoring of the ions which are emitting in both direction. This is our first result on ion acceleration. So here we have used 6.5 micron aluminum, and you can see nice parabola curves for hydrogen and carbon, because this is always there as a contaminant in the foil, aluminum foil. So these are the tracks, nice tracks of proton and carbons. And here we try to, as I said, that ion energy finally depends on the hot electron temperature. So we studied what is our temperature, how it depends on different foil, if you go for different foils. Then we observed for in case of nickel, one can get higher hot electron temperature compared to aluminum. And that's why we can get higher proton energy in case of nickel. So then we tried to find out what should be the optimum thickness for a foil to get a maximum proton energy. Now see, this foil thickness depends on what kind of laser prepulse you have. That is very important. In case of higher prepulse, then you cannot use very thin target, because the prepulse itself destroys your thin foil target. So when the main laser pulse comes, it is interacting with already pre-programmed plasma. So you are not creating a very high sheet field at the back of the target. And if you have a very thick foil target, in that case, you have propagation effect which will lead to lowering of this TNSF field at the rear of the target. So for each laser system, you have to have optimized what should be the minimum foil thickness which one can use for the system. So this we carried out and we optimized the foil thickness in our case. We found that nickel 6 micron gives maximum proton energy in our case, whereas in case of aluminium, if you go for thinner target, then the proton energy decreases. Whereas in case of nickel, if you go to up to 1 or 2 micron, then proton energy got up to 3 MeV, which is more than in case of aluminium. So these are some results on 150 terawatt laser. So here we observed proton energy up to 8 MeV, but later on by optimizing the pulse contrast and other things, we could get up to 12 MeV proton, and carbon is more than 14 MeV. So these are the scaling laws which we observed for proton. And these are the proton beam recorded on a film, RCF film, using different foil thicknesses. Now later on we carried out these experiments on a gold thin layer coated on silicon substrate. So in this case, what we observed very peculiar thing, that though the carbon and hydrogen, they got parabolic shape, that is TNSA acceleration they are showing, but in case of gold, they all parabola traces starting from a constant velocity line. That means all have the same maximum energy for different gold ion species. So it is giving clear hint on uncharacteristic of TNSA. It is non-TNSA acceleration is showing, and all have same maximum energy. Later on, we decrease the gold nano layer to 220 nanometer. In that case also, we got same features. But see, here we are getting bunching of the gold ions. You can see these are pronounced peaks which are appearing here. These are the trace taken across the parabola. So one can see bunching. So this is monogenic causes bunching appears in case of gold. If you reduce the gold layer thickness, it is same substrate. Now further we went for a substrate, a target which is coated with nano gold particle and embedded in carbon film on silicon substrate. In this case also, no, they are embedded in carbon film which is deposited on the silicon substrate. So in this case, we got quite enhanced monogenetic features. All are having same energy, okay. So these are unconventional. This you cannot get such thing from TNSA mechanism. Now same thing, if you see in case of silicon, now there is a problem with the presentation. In case of silicon also, this silicon, if you see the Q by M ratio of silicon and gold, okay, they are matching closely. And here also you can see gold 6 plus, they are matching. Of course, all these are having same constant energy, but they match quite close to silicon silicon 1 plus. That means in case of gold only, nanoparticle we get bunching, whereas in case of silicon, it is normal TNSA experiment. It is a TNSA acceleration mechanism. Now if you we observed multiple bunching also. Now this is occurs when you got nanoparticles, they are scattered all along the film in different depth. That also can lead to multiple bunching. So this we did and did some simulation on this. Ajit will be presenting some result on this. So there we got multiple bunching. Quite pronounced multiple bunching with a nano particle. And this we could simulate also experimentally. And then we found that it is due to different gold nanoparticle embedded in different depths, and that is resulting into multi bunching. And similarly, then we later on we prepared a target with a known layer of gold thickness embedded at different depth. So in that case also we observed, in case of single layer we got one single bunching, in case of multiple layer of gold deposited on the carbon layer alternate, we got multiple bunching. Now coming to negative ion acceleration, first time we observed negative ion acceleration also in thin, in transparent material. So here we have used simple PMMA, that is acrylic transparent material, and if you focus the laser beam in a PMMA, then you get a negative ion acceleration in the case only when the pre-pulse is very low, that is at 1 nanosecond pre-pulse, you can see the higher H minus population. As you increase the pre-pulse level, this decreases sharply. Similarly, we observed that ion acceleration is observed in case of beam is focused deep into the target. Like see, this is, suppose it is focused at the surface of the PMM, then there is no negative ion observation. But if it beam is focused deep into the PMMA, then we get negative ion acceleration. And here the flux of negative ion is quite good compared to conventional negative ion source. And we also detected neutral ions from some experiment. Here we are using same TPAIs, but we are putting electric field and magnetic field in such a way that all ions, charged particles, they are away from the detector area. What you get is the only neutral, which is center, and followed by, of course, you have X-rays also which are coming. So by recording the ion signal from MCP, one can calculate the neutral ion flux also. In case of neutral ion generation, we observed also that it is more in case of small pre-pulse, and the moment if you increase the pre-pulse, it decreases. So this is the first observation of observing neutrals from transparent target. So the origin of H minus and H plus, we did some simulation. We observed that in case, in both cases I mentioned that the laser beam has to focus deep inside the target. So if you focus beam in such a way, then the, on the surface it got enough intensity to create an initial plasma. So you can see the evolution of plasma as time. So initially when beam, there is no beam, this is the surface of the target, and then as you go ahead in the time, then at 140 femtosecond initial plasma is created by the beam and you get emission of electron from the surface, okay. But later on when beam, main beam comes, which is focused deep inside the target, then that leads to second layer of the electron which are coming. Now you can see at different time scale, the second bunch of electron as well as protons, they are coming. So when this second layer of proton, when it comes from the deep inside from the target, it gets enough population of the electron which gets neutralized, which can get to H minus as well as to neutralize. So that's why you see both flux, H minus as well as neutral. And in case of carbon and oxygen, in this case you don't see such an effect. So there is, if you see the time evolution of the laser pulse, so in this case there is no electron emission, okay. Similarly in this case also there is no second layer which is coming, so we don't see any C minus or oxygen minus negative ions in this. So finally I'll conclude that RRCAT is a premier institute with the state of laser facilities, and soon we'll have petawatt laser facility which will be operational in by end of 2018. We've got a strong group pursuing research in areas of laser plasma based particle accelerators, and so here I'll just mention brief our important results: demonstration of bunched heavy ion acceleration in intense laser plasma interaction, then hydrodynamic expansion of gold. Here basically hydrodynamics of gold expansion emits carbon layer yielding monogenetic gold ion emission. And observed first time 100 kV negative ion from the plasma. You have gold nanoparticles which are embedded in carbon film and it is mounted on substrate. So when you, and this gold nanoparticle thickness is very small, hundreds of nanometer only. So nanoparticle, they are scattered from 2 to 10 nanometers, okay. So basically laser is getting focused at the substrate and creates a plasma there. and the plasma expands because of hydrodynamics expansion, they push the gold ions. Okay, and on the top of you got carbon which inhibits it. So sort of that it creates a stagnation layer at the front of the gold ions, and at the back you have substrate, pusher. So that way you get bunching of the gold ions. Gold ions scattered throughout the depth, then you can get multiple bunching of such ions. Because the push which is getting from substrate is same, okay? So that will lead to same velocity. No, it is not electrostatic. It's a plasma push, hydrodynamic push which they are getting from the substrate. And since the intensity is very high, yeah, due to plasma pressure, and intensity is enough to ionize the gold particle to Au plus 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Hundreds of keV. Because it is plasma push only, so we don't get very high energy. But you get bunching, which is monogenetic sort of. See, this prepulse comes inherently with the laser system. We are not giving any prepulse. Whatever laser you have, that will have some prepulse in it. That is, we call it ASE prepulse contrast ratio.